Hello, my name's Jordan.
My name's Rhiannon.
And this is Better Building with Buck, episode 3. We are going to discuss cost per square foot and how much it costs to build a house on Vancouver Island. So today we're going to kind of discuss what that looks like and try and give a better understanding to when people ask how much does it cost per square foot, because that can be a very interesting question depending on who you're asking and how educated you are on what kind of response you want to get back out of that. Because if you just ask that question without understanding what we're going to discuss today, you could be misled, or you may disqualify a builder because you didn't actually, what they believed was cost per square foot compared to what you believe was cost per square foot. It's trying to get the apples to apples, especially when you're comparing any pricing to anybody else. So I guess today Rhiannon's going to kind of ask some questions to me about it, and then we're gonna go through a bunch of questions that would make sense that you'd want to understand when you are asking a question like that, or you're trying to understand how much it does cost to build a house in Vancouver Island.
Excellent. Okay, so I'm gonna start with one of the most commonly asked questions, and I'm gonna kind of pose it as if I was like a client talking to Jordan. So come in, I engage Buck Robertson Contracting, and right off the bat, I'm like, well, what's going to be the general idea of this cost? And that is the broadest question when it comes to this detailed process. So first one I'm going to start with, so I come in and say I have shot the question to Jordan of how much is it going to cost me to build my house? Jordan's first question is probably going to be, well, is the land included? So tell me more a little bit about that and your experience with that.
So it's important to understand when you're asking that cost per square foot or how much does it cost to build a house. Are you including the land? Are you not including the land? Are you understanding that different land costs are very greatly all over Vancouver Island? So I guess it's less about the cost per square foot and how much is it going to cost me to build a house is where this kind of question plays more into. Because if it is really, if you're like, say you're comparing, am I going to buy a house or am I going to build a house? And so understanding the difference on, okay, well, this house is actually the house cost plus the land cost that comes to that price. So if you're looking in the market and trying to understand what you want, it's good to understand, you know, what you're doing, the apples to apples. I'm probably going to repeat that a lot today, but it's very important. It's interesting because there's not a very standardized process in how construction is put together and costing, and everybody prices things a little bit differently. And understanding that every project is a prototype is important too. So that if you're trying to get an idea of price, you actually have to understand a lot more about where this house is and kind of, other questions like that. But
good. Thanks, yeah. Jordan. Cool. So the next question that is, we would frequently ask our clients who are engaging with us would be, so what type of home are you interested in designing? What type of home are you interested in building? And if you shoot back to our episode 2, we can elaborate further. We did elaborate further on what type of home you could be building, so you can go back and do that. But so Jordan would be asking me, well, what do you want to build?
So there's, you know, you could be trying to build a one-story house. It could be a walkout rancher. Could be a two-story house. It could be going back to like a single story. It could be like a sprawling house where, like, you know, maybe it's separated into quadrants and you got breezeways, so now you're having to build these like sections out to different parts of the property to make it all connect together. You could have a flat roof, a peaked roof, it goes on and on. The complexity of the design too, and trying to understand that all of those parts too can be, you know, more or less expensive. Yeah, there's a lot of pieces, and to try and broadly put a stroke on how much does it cost is really not an easy answer.
Yeah, that would be very difficult to determine that early on in the stages. Cool. So you want me to move on to the next?
Yeah, yeah. You might as well. Yeah, sure.
Good. So next would be another question to kind of consider is, would it be just the minimum code requirement type house, or would it be a high functioning house? And that would be relative to sort of if you were planning on designing your forever custom home, or you just wanted to do this for resale or something. So
yeah. So when we're thinking about what type of home, we can have a code minimum built house, which is going to be the legal, the minimum legal requirements that you could build a home to, which is, there's nothing wrong with that house. It's just, you're not going to have the same level of comfort within the home. So we will talk more about comfort in the future and what kind of different degrees of comfort you can have. But I think everybody's been in a house where you're, let's say the summer, and you're upstairs in the second story of this house, and it's so hot that you'd rather be outside because it's actually nicer outside because you have a breeze compared to being in the second story of the house. So that's a house that has very little thermal comfort. So what we're going to talk about is a little bit today, and we will go into it more in the future, is what a high performance home is. And a high performance home is something that's got a really good building envelope. It's got a good fresh air system. So you say you have a good exchange of nice fresh air coming into your house to make sure you stay healthy and comfortable all year round. But yeah, and then when you think about high performance homes, there's also different degrees. So right now in our building code, we have a step 3 home, a step 4 home, and a step 5 home. And each one of those brings a little bit different level of comfort. We're moving towards this step 5 home, which is a net zero or net zero ready home. Which that's another thing we'll discuss more about in the future. There's also a passive house, which is then another level above that. It going through and understanding what type of home you want. And you know what? Maybe going into this process, you don't know what a high performance home is. And that's something that we'll sit down and explain to you about what the advantages are. One of the big advantages in my mind is the durability in which you have in your home.
Yeah. Longevity, I was thinking too, like just longevity of products and the home itself.
Sorry. Yeah, for sure. Mm-hmm. They say with a passive home that you could heat your whole house with a blow dryer. So you're actually trying to, like, any heat that gets inside, you're actually trying to deal with how are we exhausting that. And that's where HRV or an ERV comes in handy, and we definitely will go into more in the future about what that is and try and educate everybody so that they, when they go to pick out this house, and they're trying to think about the cost per square foot, or they're trying to think about how much is this house going to cost me, they're actually also thinking about the health and the comfort in which you're expecting out of this home, so that you can then yet again go apples to apples. Are you comparing the builder that's building a code minimum house, or are you built going and you're comparing a high performance home to another high performance home? So that's that kind of wrapped up in a,
that's great,
maybe neat little bow that needs to be,
yeah, it was good, yeah,
opened up later.
Yeah, definitely. We will be elaborating on that much further, hoping to get some guest speakers in regards to net zero and passive houses as well, so stay tuned for that.
Yeah.
Next I'm just going to give you an example. It's me as a client. So hi, I'm looking at this super flat lot in a subdivision, or I'm looking at this crazy sloping lot on Pender Island with a ton of rock and boulders very close to the high water mark. Which is going to be, what are the costs going to be in comparison to those, Jordan?
Yeah, so those are two completely different projects, and both of those projects could happen on Vancouver Island.
Mm-hmm.
So understanding that the lot in which you're planning on building on has a huge, huge impact on the total cost of your project. So one of those things could be, for instance, does this lot even have a road or a driveway to it? You could be having to deal with bringing in power. You could have to have septic. You could have to have a well. You could have some sort of riparian zone?
Riparian area.
Which is when she's talking about being by the water. You could also have that if you have a course of water going through your property. But yeah, those are things that would impact your project. So understanding the land. Oh, I guess one other thing about that too is, are you building on rock or are you building on something that you can dig a hole that's, you know, 2-3 feet deep, put a foundation in and go from there. Those are two completely different projects. You could have rock breaking or blasting, you know, from, let's call it like $30,000 up to $100,000+ if you're trying to build on the side of a mountain. And then the engineering and all, yeah.
The engineering. Yeah. You've got, you know, huge posts going into these areas. You've got to think about those costs as well.
So, yeah. So, and you know, when you have a design build company, they have the ability to kind of navigate through these design choices as it's getting developed instead of having a plan that gets designed and then now you're trying to go out and get pricing because you've designed this really spectacular home that you really got drawn up and you couldn't afford. So when you have design build, they can definitely kind of help you navigate and understand, like, you know, you could be between this and this for pricing, and you go, maybe that's not how much money I want to spend on my foundation.
Yeah.
And the view was great, but do I want to spend to get out of the ground $200,000? It's a question to be had. So yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah.
So the next question that we've organized is kind of just, it was very similar to what we had just talked about. So what does the land look like that you're trying to build this home on? So we kind of just went over that. It's hugely varying all over Vancouver Island.
No, that's fine. And you know, like there's different soil conditions too. Mm-hmm. You could have clay. There's like, up in Duncan, they have like a lot of, they have some shale in some of their developments. I went and looked at one the other year. And so, yeah, we have all different sources, types of material where some places where you build, you'll be digging and most often you're digging something very similar. But here we have just all sorts of different conditions.
Ecologically sensitive areas as well.
Yeah,
and a lot of protected trees, which is really important. And that also will drive up the cost because you're going to need to be getting other professionals in here to determine sort. I didn't mean to interrupt you there.
No, that's good. Yeah. No, whatever you got to feed into this is great.
Yeah. So just things like that will add into the cost of your property that people are typically not aware of until we say, okay, well, you have to engage in this other professional and this other professional to get the ball kind of rolling. So,
yeah.
Sorry, go on.
No. I probably don't have much more to add to that.
Cool. We kind of covered a lot in the last question with that one too. So, okay, cool. So, I'm super interested to hear your input on this one. So, what would be a better building time for me, Jordan? Should I be planning to build in the spring or should I be planning to build in the fall? So, the question is posed for what time of year are we going to be building and how is that going to affect the cost?
Yeah, so say you were just starting to frame in the middle of winter. So you're going to have the fact that your house has got soaking wet. So you're probably going to have like about, let's call it maybe a week delay in the project just to make sure that you get it really good and dry before you start sticking insulation in the wall. Because the last thing that you want is for the walls to start molding out and have moisture stuck within the material. So yes, the building inspector does come and he does do a moisture test on the wood. But if he misses somewhere and you haven't actually tried to dry the house out the best you can, then obviously there's going to be a cost to that. Another thing to think about too is, I think this was also posed a little bit about timeline about,
The next question was timeline.
Yeah, okay. So sorry.
You can kind of cover that if you wanted.
Yeah. So the timeline too. So like if you are trying to really fast track your house and the speed in which it needs to be built, there's an amount of planning that has to go into that. So yeah, everybody wants to build their house as fast as you can. And yes, every project should have a schedule built out and a timeline. But some people really want to get in as soon as possible. So what ends up happening, and we call it, it's trade stacking, where you have more than one trade that's at the building at one time. And it drives the trades nuts because all they want to do is they want to go, they want to do their job, and have the space in which to do that. And they don't want to be climbing over, you know, this guy's got his ladder there and I'm supposed to be trying to do this. And so there's the trades are, they have the potential of losing money. So if they need to do the job as fast as they can, they need to make sure that they can get in there and be able to do the work that they can. So that organization of coordinating everybody has to go even to a higher level. And so I think that understanding that the timeline of a project is important. Also, when it comes to timeline, you can also think about like, do we have everything picked out, and is everything going to be there in that timeline? Say you haven't even picked out your kitchen, but you want to build your house in the next, say it was 3 months or something. You want your house built in 3 months, which would be a pretty quick house. It'd be, I don't know, almost possible, but your kitchen might not even be ready. So just understanding that.
I'm stressed thinking about it.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, sometimes you got to try and see if you can make something work, but that's, you know, it's a matter of just going through that process and seeing, okay, can we actually make this work? And sometimes things work and sometimes they don't, but you know, if you don't plan for it, you're definitely not going to have success for that project.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Unexpected things happen even if you've planned up and down for things. So it's just really important to just plan as best as you possibly can.
Pandemic happens and you can't find any material that you need, and everybody is working more than they ever thought that they were going to. Mm-hmm. You can't get the trades, you can't get the material, can't get the plans.
Yeah, were backlogged for like 4 or 5 months, I think, through the pandemic. It was bonkers.
Yeah, so that's something that's not foreseen. So I
think we'll skip that one and go right next to this one.
Yeah, good.
Okay, so the next important question that I feel like we would be asking before you started your project was, how big do you want your home to be and how does that affect the cost?
Yeah, so when it goes to how big is your home, I'm always going to be trying to bring your house size down, because we're going to be trying to understand how you function in your house. I've talked about that a little bit on the last podcast about, understanding, you know, how you function in your house so you can make that house smaller. And when you make your house smaller, you can also potentially, if your budget allows it, you could, up the quality of the things, which also could potentially make it more durable. Having a durable home is great, because who's got time to be monkeying around with getting people out to come and work on their house again after, you know, you feel like you just finished it.
Yeah, for sure.
So something else about how big is the house is like, when we talk about cost per square foot, the cost per square foot potentially on a house can actually go down when it gets bigger. But the soft costs, which are all the costs that are associated with getting organized to get the project started, they can go up, as well as things like the management on a project, because that gets extended. So if you were asking somebody and they were trying and you were going, okay, how much does it cost per square foot to build a house? Then they're gonna say, well, typically we build 6,000 square foot homes, so it costs this much, where compared to if you asked another builder that usually builds 1,500 to 2,000 square foot homes, they might say a different number. But the thing is if it's a smaller house, you still need a kitchen, you still need a bathroom, you still need a laundry room, you still need, I don't know, those are some of the more expensive rooms in the house. So that ups the cost per square foot compared to a bigger home where you got, you know, more just surface area. Yeah, you're still paying for framing and flooring and blah, 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 but you're not paying for
cabinets
and millwork and stuff like that, unless you're going to a really high level finish of a house. And then, yeah, maybe you're not saving any money at cost per square foot because you have, you know,
wainscoting, or sorry.
No. Yeah, that's exactly. No, I want to hear that.
Bunch of extra architectural details, you know, coved and moldings and such.
Yeah, and then it goes on and on with like that cost per square foot. So understanding what kind of house you're trying to build is important.
Mm-hmm.
and making sure you get that across, or at least you're open to hearing somebody's opinion about it instead of, you know, calling up and going, hey, how much does it cost to build per square foot? Okay, thank you, bye. It's like, you didn't solve any problem. All you did was you're trying to find out who's going to do it, the house for the cheapest, and you absolutely get the cheapest person to build your house.
And that might not turn out so great.
Yeah.
So
I'm not bitter about it at all.
No, not at all. Okay, good. So our next question that we're going to be posing in regards to building your house and what it would cost is this home going to need engineering? And people, so given sort of the desires for what people want in their homes today, i.e. open concepts, big windows, tall walls, vaulted ceilings, a lot of the designs will require a little bit of engineering. So that's sort of what I have to add to that, and I'll get Jordan to kind of tap in, but yeah, sorry.
No, that's okay. Yeah, so some projects will need engineering, especially if you have a really complicated project. So that goes back again to kind of the first question of what kind of house are we trying to build? Mm-hmm. So if trying to get from you what you have in your head is a big part of it. So if you can't articulate that, or you don't have some sort of design to look to, and you're literally just trying to figure out a cost without understanding what type of project you're trying to build, then you're not able to get an answer. And the thing is like, the answer that you're going to get is going to, most builders will, should be able, or should be saying something that's pretty wide open, because they don't know. And as you go through this design and build or get a plan designer to, or an architect to draw you some plans, then you start to figure out what the scope of work is, and then somebody can start to put pricing towards something, because, you know, every project is a prototype. We're not an assembly line, and we have to design things and work our way through it, and then some things need to end up going to the engineer. And you know what? The engineer isn't always this cost that people are like, oh, we got to get this engineer in.
Totally.
And they go, oh, Jesus, like, can we afford that? And usually, like, depending on the scope of the work, the engineer could be like a percent or less than a percent of the total cost of the project. So, you know, it really depends. So, like, if you're going crazy architectural design, something where, like, you know, maybe your half your house is floating out and it looks like
cantilever
stuff. Yeah, a bunch of weird engineering.
Infinity pool.
Yeah.
Big hot tub and huge post. And sorry.
No, exactly. Yeah. And yeah, so as soon as you start getting out of part 9, which is where most construction is, then it starts to get a little bit more complicated, and mm-hmm. and the more things that you design outside of part 9 that can't have a definition or like a detail or a way in which they can approach that and gets outside of part 9, then there's a cost that's associated with that.
And I just want to sort of add to is it does sound intimidating when the city does say, oh, you know, we need a Schedule B here, and that means you need an engineer. It does sound intimidating, but also just keep in mind that sometimes those engineers are just coming in and they're specifying one big beam in your house, and that's it. So it can be a smaller amount of engineering, as long as you're planning for that in your mind, it can be not as intimidating to get an engineer on a project.
That's a good way of putting it, because, like, you think, hear it, and you go, oh, that's either going to cost much, or how long is this going to take too? And yeah, sometimes there's a time penalty or time issue with, you know, trying to figure out, okay, now we got to find an engineer, or, you know, maybe the city saw something that you didn't see while you were designing, and now you have to get an engineer. Yeah. Sometimes on projects you will be building something, and you're part of the way through building it, and then the inspector will come, and he will then tell you that you need an engineer on something that wasn't called out on your plans, and also you hadn't seen either. So then they look at it and they go, oh, no, this doesn't work. You have to get an engineer. So
And as annoying as it is at the time, that's a good thing. It's a good thing that, you know, your house, we obviously want your house to be built sound. So it's definitely would be frustrating to hear that from the inspector, but in the end, it needs to get done, and you'll be better off for it. Yeah. So,
yeah, for sure. The reason why I kind of brought that up is just because, you know, there now this plan that's being designed has gone through the plan designer. They've looked it over. Then goes to the builder. They've looked it over. Then the plan checker. They've looked it over. And then it's not till it actually makes it to site that things start getting put together that somebody, the building inspector, has noticed that, oh, this actually got missed. So you're three people through this, the check of your plans, before now it's on site and something's being made apparent.
Mm-hmm.
So it's just good to understand that, like, we are building things in the field, and so making sure that you are aware that, you know, it's a process, and you just got to kind of work your way through that. And just because you need to get engineering does not mean that, you know, it's a fatal part of your project not being able to move ahead or work.
Absolutely. Yeah. I've worked with engineers who've just designed like a single knee brace that we just spec'd on a house for a big deck. So it's not as intimidating as it sounds.
Yeah.
Cool. Good. Okay, good. So next question, that's a pretty common question that we would ask in regards to pricing, is what type of finishes do you want to see in your home?
There's all different types of material, and there's all different levels of finish. Also, like, the level of quality that things get finished at. So understanding that different builders have different subtrades that come into is important. So going out and actually walking somebody's job or watching a video of that somebody's made of their project, so you can have a good idea of what their quality of finish is important, because it goes back to the apples to apples that, you know, just because somebody's going to build you your house for X per square foot does not mean that you're going to get the same house from the next person. So we're talking about finishes, though. So the level of finish, you know, you can go from a hardwood floor to a laminate floor and anything in between as far as quality. And then inside each one of those types of flooring, then you have a level of quality of those types of flooring. So, yeah, the finish on the inside of the house maybe isn't the, like, main thing that's going to break your budget on your project, but it is important to understand that every time you put another layer, so let's talk about trim, for instance. So say you have some very basic trim, and somebody told you, yeah, we can finish your house, and you don't even ask about the trim package because you just assume in your mind that this is the type of trim that every house has, but you could also have multiple layers. So every time you have another layer of trim, that's another time that somebody has to do a lap around your house. So the more layers that you build out, you're kind of multiplying that cost. And then also there's the caulking and the sanding, or if it's, you know, a wood trim, then maybe it's the level of craftsmanship that you actually have to have of trades that come in, because all those joints that finish up have to finish, you know, pretty damn good.
Mm-hmm.
If you have any kind of workmanship.
Yeah. Cool. I move on to the next.
Sure. Awesome. Yeah, that sounds good.
We did kind of touch on this in one of our last questions, but let's chat about it again.
Okay.
So availability of materials.
So the availability of materials is really crucial, and understanding the timeline in which a material needs to get there. So every product, or not every, but lots of products, you should make sure that you have start building out a timeline of when that person has to pick out that product for when it would have to be delivered. So usually a good kind of rule of thumb is the person that you're going to be ordering those products from, you kind of give them a rough idea of what you're going to be having for materials. Then you're going to ask them, okay, what are you having issues with getting right now? Now, the pandemic didn't help, because it was like this. It's a roller coaster of, like, okay, I can't get any of this. And then you have that material and then you can't get any of that. And so the whole time you're trying to build, you're chasing around these products, and maybe they call it front loading, where you're actually ordering materials before the project started. And then when you get to that part, maybe that material is actually available, but now something else that you need has now not been available. So now you're still at a standstill in the same spot. It's just a different. So for instance, when COVID was happening, it was really hard to get 4-inch perforated pipe, which is what wraps around your house so that the perimeter drain runs the water that gets through the dirt and runs it out to the road or daylight it or whatever. That was really hard to find. So if you were trying to build your project and you couldn't find any 4-inch perforated pipe, your project is actually stopped, or at least the backfill stopped, which makes it then harder for the framers to get started. Because you have to get that inspected and it has to be installed. So yeah, you could, you know, backfill your whole foundation, the whole outside of your house, and then wait for your perimeter drain to show up and then redig it all up. But then there's a cost to that, right? Mm-hmm. So that's just kind of one example of something that happened recently. Mm-hmm. And there was all sorts of other weird things, and there was glass shortages and blah, 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 blah. But some things are starting to settle out, so that's good. And you know, navigating through that and having a good pulse on what's affected and what's not is key. And asking your contractor, oh, okay, well, what do you think what's an issue right now? And maybe he's not going to have the answer for you right then, and that's probably a good thing, because he's going to go out and actually ask the people that are closer to the front lines, because there's so many different types of material that has to go into a project.
Goodness, yes, yeah. So. Cool. Interesting. Yeah. Thanks for that. Outdoor areas. So that's another thing that we haven't actually chatted about. Outdoor areas or garages. Are you going to have an enclosed garage? Are you going to have a carport? Are there going to be any outdoor decks, patios? That's another question that Jordan would be posing.
Yeah. So when I was thinking about this question, I was thinking about it as when you're asking the contractor about this cost per square foot. Are they including the garage or not including the garage? Good. Are they including the covered porch, the deck, the covered deck?
Yeah.
All of these pieces, they still need a roof. They still need walls. So say it's a garage. So the garage still needs a roof, still needs walls, still needs a slab. So it needs concrete underneath it. So now you've maybe cut out. Oh, it's still, it usually will get insulation, drywall, lighting. The only thing that it doesn't have is a floor finish. And depending on what you actually want your garage to look like, the concrete, you could actually be making that up. As far as, like, say you went with a epoxy floor in your garage, then now that cost per square foot is exactly the same as what it's going to cost you for, you know, the cost for your living room floor or living room square footage. So that's like, yeah, that's important. And then when it goes to like a covered porch or a covered deck, so you've got the framing, you're going to have the deck finish, you're going to have the roof, the soffit. Yeah, so there's so many pieces there too. So now if you're not including, so I'm going to kind of propose a question, and it's like, so say you had a house and you went and you asked, how much does it cost per square foot? So now you have this house and it costs X amount of dollars, and now you start going out and you ask, okay, this builder, how much does you charge per square foot? How much do you charge and how much do you charge? Now, do all those builders include the cost per square foot of the garage and the covered porches, or do they not? And what about the crawl space? Is that included or is that not included? Now, if you took the number, the lowest number, and that was for the cost per square foot, but they didn't include any of those spaces, and then you pay that on top, then if you were doing that as like a rough budget to try and figure out how much your house is going to cost, then you're going to be way out to whack. Think about a garage. It's usually 20 by 20, so 400 square feet right there.
Yeah.
And
think about a crawl too, like all of the additional costs that go into a huge crawl space would be a big punch in the face for adjustment to your budget if you weren't expecting that, I feel like.
Yeah, for sure.
Concrete costs and...
Yeah, like, and you know, your crawl space could be going from, let's call it 2 feet down to 6 feet. Well, the whole side wall, that still has to get sided, framed in, or maybe it's concrete, so that's a cost. You still have all the floor joists. You still have the ground seal or slab underneath that and the framing to get up to there. So there's obviously a cost to that. And so understanding that, you know, what house are we trying to build here? What's the goal? How are we heating the house? Because now you might be more inclined to have a crawl space because you want to go with a forced air system. And that's fine, but there's a cost to that. So what kind of house are we trying to build here?
Yeah. Cool. Awesome. And finished or unfinished spaces. So that's another good question is like we just worked on a custom house and they basically planned the top as like a rancher living, but due to the shape of the lot, we planned it as a step down so they could maximize on that area. And it's basically going to be an unfinished basement. So tell us a little bit about how...
Yeah, so this is kind of another thing that goes back to this cost per square foot. Now, how do you determine your unfinished spaces? And have you not even included that because you assumed, oh, it's unfinished, so maybe I said it was half the cost or something like this. Now, okay, so you still have the frame, still have the insulation, still have the siding, you still have the slab or floor system, and you still have to drywall some of it, at least, maybe not to the same level.
Electrical.
Yeah. You might have rough-in plumbing for a bathroom in the future. Yeah. So yeah, you're not saving a lot of costs.
Windows, you got to think to put down there as well if you're planning for bedrooms in the future. And sorry.
Yeah. No, exactly. Yeah. And so you're not... Yeah, you are saving a little bit of money by not finishing it right away, but it's not to the extent that I think most people would think that it is.
Mm-hmm.
So understanding how your house is actually going to fit onto the lot, and are you going to have to build out that square footage anyways to fit the house that you're hoping to put on that land? Like maybe you want a rancher, but no matter what, you're still going to have this step down, whether you do that out of concrete or you frame it and side it and make it look like something.
Yeah.
That's, you still got to get there.
Yeah.
Unless you're going to maybe do it on like a post and beam style house where it's, you know, you've got the whole underside open. But that's a whole nother can of worms to try and
navigate
through all that.
That'll drive up those engineering costs. Yeah.
So what kind of house are we trying to build here?
Yeah. Okay, next, this one's a great question. So does this property have services, i.e. water, sewer, and other utilities to it, or does it need well and septic? So please elaborate further on that one for us, Jordan.
Yeah, so when you go out and you're looking at land with a realtor, you're excited, you want to build a house, and you might, your realtor maybe will be inclined to bring up this information that this is what you're going to have to sort out. Say for instance, okay, you thought I got to get the well and I got to get the septic. Now, maybe you didn't kind of think about how are we going to get power up here. So maybe you're going to have to bring power from, you know, a couple of blocks away. You might have 6 telephone poles to put in before you can actually get to your house. Yeah.
Wow, interesting.
Yeah, and BC Hydro is only going to go so far from each pole. So now you could be paying for a shit ton of that work.
Wow. Yeah. That's a crazy cool perspective to share. I never knew that.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah, so all these things can change, and then now so you're thinking about septic. So how many toilets are you going to have? How big is this septic field going to have to be?
How many dwellers are in the house?
Yeah.
Like, are you going to be room and boarding people? Are you going to be, that's really important. Can the septic that you're going to be installing on your property, is it going to be able to handle the house that you've designed?
Yeah. Is the well water that actually gets drilled and pulled out, or are you even happy to drink it?
Is it potable? Yeah. That's like, and then it could also tap into, oh no, we found that this is now an ecological area or something. And yeah, so really good question.
Yeah. So as you can see, just asking how much does it cost without having any of this information is going to make it really tricky. So if you're wanting to, you know, dig into and start making a long list of questions that you may or may not know to ask, then yeah. But if you're interested in, you know, working with the design build team that's going to be able to start asking you the proper questions because they've had the experience to go through and ran into these issues, maybe they're not going to know the answer right away. Maybe they haven't run into that issue, but you know, builders are really good problem solvers, and we'll do our best to try and get to the bottom of it and try and get some answers for you.
Mm-hmm. Excellent. So we've got two more questions left. And again, we've kind of touched on a lot of the things here. They're all pretty relative to each other. So the next one is this a one-story home or a two-story home? And we probably don't even need to go that far into it because we did just elaborate on it.
Yeah, I'll just share. So when you're building, the difference between a one-story home and a two-story home is the two-story home is always going to be cheaper in almost 90% of situations because you're going to share the foundation, mm-hmm. and you're also going to share that roof. So then you have a whole nother floor that's underneath those two expensive pieces. The other thing to think about that long term is your roof, the durability and the longevity of the roof is that now you also, when you do have to replace your roof, that you're only replacing it for, or it's a smaller square footage of roofing, so now you don't have to deal with that. So that's another, you know, thinking about costs, life cycle costs, or costs of the total length of that you're going to live there. Some people may only live, most people actually live in a house for, you know, between 7 and 10 years, and 10 years is probably a stretch. So understanding, you know, how long that roof's going to last, when you're going to have to replace it, how big is this roof going to be? So that's kind of the one story, two story kind of thing. It's just understanding that if you go up, it's cheaper than going out because you got more foundation and more roof.
Yeah, interesting.
And more chance for issues because now you got more, you have to dig a bigger hole. So that's another cost. Perimeter drain and everything else. And
it might not even, you know, your lot might not allow for a rancher because you'd be amazed at how big ranchers can get when you're trying to fit everything into people's wish list.
Yeah, well, that's fair.
Yeah, yeah. Like they can take up a lot of space.
So. Yeah.
Okay, so, good. Last question here that we've got is, this is a good one. So how is the accessibility of the property? Can we get large machinery in and out easy? So have you had that experience before?
The house that we built on Siwash Ridge, actually we have two kind of things. So on Siwash Ridge though, we had the concrete company come out and they wanted us to actually set up two pump trucks, one pump truck at the bottom of the hill that would pump into another pump truck, which then would pump up the hill and then would pump into the back of the pump truck so we could pump the foundation. But instead what we did is we rented a huge, like a 18-wheeler tow truck, and they came and actually we put a come along on and they pulled the pump truck up and then pulled it back up the hill.
Wow.
So,
awesome.
Yeah, so we saved a cost there by trying to think our way through that. Actually, that was my brother. He thought his way through that. And so the accessibility. So every single delivery that we got was some sort of issue. So, we ended up having to actually speak to a supplier and say, we can only take this one truck. And what happened? About a third of the time, we didn't get that truck. And then they would have to pack the material up the hill.
Goodness.
And we would say, okay, well, we asked for the truck. It didn't show up. So figure out how you're going to get it up here.
Oh my goodness. How frustrating. Oof.
Yeah.
That's another cool perspective. Thank you. I've never experienced that, being the little person.
Yeah. And one other thing is we had another property that had to do with power and getting power there. And they actually, BC Hydro had suggested that we did the guy that was going to place the poles has suggested maybe that we do a heli pole landing so that you would dig a hole, then they would take the the telephone pole and bring it in by a helicopter and drop it. And we said, sounds a little bit much and expensive. So we actually were lucky enough. We spoke to the neighbor and the neighbor was able to give us a variance. And so we were able to bring power across from their pole and bring it onto our property. So that saved us, you know, probably, I think it was about $40,000 there.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. And you just have to think too of, you know, life cycle analysis too, like when you're getting vehicles involved like that, like how is that good for the environment or net zero homes? It just sort of seems like it just works against us in regards to like the whole thing.
Yeah.
So when you were just telling me about the multiple dump trucks, I was like, what? Like that is probably not. Yeah. Sorry.
No.
Kind of went through my brain. Thought I'd share that. Good.
But, yeah. So the cost, per square foot to actually build a home can vary. And we brought that up. And so understanding that, you know, when you're going about trying to get costing from people, that you want to have the right questions to ask them, because if you're not asking the right questions, you're getting no value and you're setting yourself up for an unsuccessful project.
We will help you. You know, sometimes you won't have the proper questions to this build, but that's what we're here for as well, is we've got a ton of things and questions that we would add to your list as well. And also, yes, so of course it's important to know what you're going to be spending when you're doing this, but it is impossible for anybody to properly give you an idea until you have thought out the process a little bit. And if you were to move ahead, if somebody were to give you, this is, you know, just you engage, you send an email, and they come back with a quote for you based on the whole build, chances are your expectations throughout that process are going to be crumbled a little bit, right? Because you haven't thought out everything that we've just gone over, which, as you can hear, there's so many variables, so many moving parts when it comes to building your home. And as Jordan says, every project is a prototype. So you just have to have a bit of flexibility when it comes to your expectations, and knowing, yeah, things are going to change throughout the project, and you just got to plan really well. It's so important to plan.
Yeah.
Sorry.
No, that's exactly it. So, I really appreciate that everybody's been tuning in, this is Better Building with Buck, and I hope you guys all have a great day.
Okay, thanks, bye everybody. For now. Bye-bye. Is that right? Oh my God.